Hello, and welcome to the episode 60 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Nothing happened in any of the 29th of February that popped up on the calendar while the Quarrymen or the Beatles were still together. And so today, we will focus on the various 1st of March, as well as on those events whose exact date can't be pinned down, but that happened at some point in March. Among other things, we will have the birth of the Quarrymen, a great studio performance, and the loss of Northern Songs. Sometime in March 1957, John Lennon acquired his first guitar, a Gallatone Champion. It was a three-quarter guitar, meaning that it was a learning instrument, smaller than normal. It is not clear who bought the guitar, nor its cost, but it was a postal order. One version of the story has John's aunt Mimi buying it for £17, about £410 in 2020 money. Another has John's mother, Julia, buying it for £10, about £240 in 2020 money. Yet another one has John himself buying it and shipping it to his mother's house to avoid scrutiny from his disapproving aunt for an undisclosed amount of money. We will never know, I guess. What we do know is that John formed his first band almost immediately after receiving the instrument. Initially, the band comprised of just Lennon and his mate Pete Shotton. The band was called the Black Jacks, but it was soon renamed the Quarrymen, after the boys' high school motto, Quarrymen, strong before our birth. The band evolved with a continuous flux of members coming and going, sometimes for just an evening. Apart from Lennon and Shotton, there were Rod Davis on banjo, Len Gary on T-chest bass, Eric Griffiths on guitar, Colin Hanton on drums, Bill Smith on T-chest bass, Ivan Vaughan on T-chest bass, Nigel Wally on T-chest bass, and many others. The band played at friends' parties and ten-a-penny skiffle contests. About 1 year later, in March 1958, the Quarrymen auditioned George Harrison for a second time, at Paul McCartney's insistence. This time the audition took place on the top deck of a bus in Speke, late at night, with George impressing the lads with a note-by-note performance of the solo from Bill Justice's guitar instrumental Runchy. John was sold, and George entered the band. On the 1st of March 1961, the Beatles, featuring Pete Best on drums, played for another BK Promotions night at the Aintree Institute in Liverpool. Exactly 1 year later, in 1962, the lads, still with Pete Best on drums, performed a lunchtime gig at the Cavern Club in Liverpool and an evening concert at the Storyville Jazz Club. The club was based on the same premises of the famous Iron Door Club, cradle of the Mercy Beat, as it's written on the commemorative plaque now on the building. Originally opened in April 1960, it changed name in 1961 and then again in 1962, becoming first the Liverpool Jazz Society and then the Storyville Jazz Club. Fun fact, it is the venue where the Beatles had played sporting for the first time the name the Silver Beatles with two E's. It was the 15th of May 1960, and we'll cover that in episode 135 of What a Fab Day. In 1963, the Beatles played the Odeon Cinema in Southport for the next stop of the Helen Shapiro National Package Tour. By the way, if you're liking the series, how about helping me to make the content even better? You can find out how you can do that by visiting www.simonmas.com/support. Every single penny will help me paying the bills and focusing more on producing more and better music-related products. On the 1st of March 1964, there was a recording session in Abbey Road for the Beatles, their first ever on a Sunday. Between 7 and 10 p.m., the band completed I'm Happy Just to Dance with You, Long Tall Sally, and I Call Your Name. Despite being considered to be included in the A Hard Day's Night soundtrack, Long Tall Sally and I Call Your Name ended up on a separate EP. Long Tall Sally was recorded in just one single take with George Martin on piano. Beatles historian Mark Lewson considers it on par with the legendary take with which the group recorded Twist and Shout. I Call Your Name was a song by John Lennon, already recorded by Billy J. Kramer and the Dakotas, featuring a shuffle rhythm during the solo that Lennon labeled as the band's attempt at ska several years later. In 1965, the Beatles kept filming their second feature film. They returned to Paradise Island, Bahamas, to shoot a scene at a French gourmet restaurant called Café Martinique. Later, Ringo Starr was filmed on a ship anchored offshore with cast members Victor Spinetti, Roy Kinnear, and Eleanor Braun. Another recording session in 1967. The Beatles were at the Abbey Road EMI studios between 7 p.m. and 2:15 a.m. The session started with a piano overdub to the existing master of A Day in the Life on the "He Blew His Mind Out in a Car" part of the verse. It was probably an experiment to dispel any doubt about the possibility of adding further colors to the song, since the track remained unused. Then, the Fabs recorded seven takes of the rhythm track of "Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds," with George Harrison's acoustic guitar and George Martin's piano on track 1, Paul McCartney's organ playing the introduction of the piece plus accompaniment on track 2, Ringo Starr's drums on track 3, John Lennon's guide vocals and maracas on track 4. Martin's piano part was reduced with every take and finally disappeared in take 7, considered the best to work on. The song was famously inspired by a painting that 3-year-old Julian Lennon brought home from his nursery school. When Lennon asked his son what the painting was, he replied, "It's Lucy in the sky with diamonds," Lucy being a girl in the same class as Julian. John was struck by inspiration and wrote the song, to which Paul McCartney added the bridge. Much was made about a conscious reference to LSD, but this was a fabrication, although the massive consumption of the drug by Lennon at this point in time led to at least some of the imagery of the lyrics. In 1968, Ringo Starr and his wife Maureen left Rishikesh, India, to go back to England, some 10 days after their arrival. The couple missed their children and was unhappy in India. Ringo, due to a childhood peritonitis, couldn't stomach the spicy Indian food and lived on canned beans and eggs, while Maureen had a phobia of flies, which were omnipresent in Rishikesh. In the anthology book, Ringo remembers, "I wasn't getting what I thought I would out of it. The food was impossible for me because I'm allergic to so many different things. I took 2 suitcases with me, one of clothes and the other full of Heinz beans. Then, one morning, the guys who were dealing with the food said, 'Would you like some eggs?' And I said, 'Oh yeah, sure.' And the next morning, they said it again. I thought, 'Oh yeah, great, things are looking up.' Then I saw them burying the shells. That was the first of several incidents that made me think that it was not what I thought it would be. You weren't supposed to have eggs inside this religious and spiritual ashram. I thought, 'What do you mean? You're burying the shells? Can't God see that too?'" On the 1st of March 1969, Paul McCartney was busy at the Morgan Studios in London, producing a session for Mary Hopkins' second single, "Goodbye," penned by Paul himself, although credited to Lennon-McCartney, as usual. Finally, in March 1969, Associated Television gained control of Northern Songs Publishing. John Lennon and Paul McCartney had tried to renegotiate their publishing deal with Dick James, or to acquire a controlling interest in the company, ever since the death of the Beatles' manager Brian Epstein on the 27th of August 1967. Their relationship with James and that of the other two Beatles had cooled off during the years past from the beginning of the enterprise, but during 1968, things took a nosedive with the band acting coldly toward their publisher every time they met, and James resenting being treated like a stranger or an enemy. In March 1969, having caught wind that Alan Klein was now the de facto manager of the Beatles and not putting any trust in his willing and dealing approach to music business, James and his partner Silver sold their shares of Northern Songs to ATV for £1,525,000, about £25,200,000 in 2020 money. They didn't give any notice of the transaction to any Beatle, nor they offered them any courtesy right of first offer. This meant that John and Paul had lost control over their publishing company and their right. Naturally, we will talk more about this subject, since, as we will see, it had several consequences on the life of the Beatles, but right now, it's time to end this episode. In the description, you can find a link to the bibliography of the podcast, with plenty of Amazon affiliate links for your Beatles shopping needs. See you tomorrow for more Beatles action. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Miles, music you love.